So hi everyone, I'm Ellie Chung from CMU Robotics Institute, and today it is my honor to introduce Dr. Torsten Sattler. Dr. Sattler currently works with Czech Institute of Informatics of Czech Technical University in Prague. And before he was an associated professor in Chalmers University of Technology in Sweden, and also a senior researcher in ETH Zurich. He is well known for his contribution in visual localization and outside this area as well. And he is also involved with the visual localization benchmarks in recent main conferences. And we are very looking forward to a talk.
Ali, thank you very much for the kind introduction. I thank you very much for the invitation. I feel honored to be here and to talk about my work. So today I'm going to talk about long-term visual localization, at least on the outset. So visual localization, let's start with the definition, to me is the problem of given an image and some scene representation, we would like to compute the exact position orientation from which this image was taken, which might be a bit different to the localization definition used in robotics, or at least I've seen visual localization definitions that are more on the retrieval side. So you would like to find an image in a database that's similar to a given test image. In this talk, I'm more focusing on, I would like to have an exact position orientation from which a given image was taken. And this has multiple applications. I guess everyone watching this series knows that visual localization is part of the robotics problem. So this is example footage from a project that I was involved in when I was at ETH Zurich. This is a gardening robot, which is designed to trim hedges and cut roses. And as part of this is its job, it needs to figure out where it is in the garden so that it can navigate to its target and then perform the cutting edge, actions. Another application is augmented reality. So you see two examples here on the left, something that we published at ECV 2014. On the right, you see an example screen capture from the AR navigation feature that is in Google Maps. In both cases, you see virtual content overlaid into the field of view of the user in order to provide additional context or information. And this is also done by figuring out where the user is with respect to some 3D scene representation. This additional content is defined in this 3D coordinate system. And once you know where the user is, you can just reproject all this 3D information into the field of view. A different application is performance capture. So this is a recent work that we presented at CVPR this year. The first authors are Vladimir Gutsov and Ayman Mir. And the idea is we would like to estimate the pose of a human in a larger scene. And of course, we could try to use external cameras, but if you look at scenes like this, like libraries with lots of empty space, you would need a lot of cameras that you would need to calibrate. We are solving this differently. We have the 3D model of the scene, and then we have a head-mounted camera, which is used to figure out where the human is in the scene. And we have body-mounted IMU sensors, which are used to estimate the human body pose. So here you see the results, which is essentially computed just from ego-mounted sensors without any external cameras. As I mentioned in this talk, I want to talk about long-term visual localization, which is essentially the problem that the world is not static, but can changes dynamically over time. So here you see three images taken at the same place in front of my former office at ETH, one in the winter, one in autumn, and one in the spring. As you can see, appearance changes quite drastically with seasons, with weather, but also with time of the year. So for example, these bushes here are tied into these knots in winter and autumn. So appearance and geometry can change over time, and visual localization algorithms should be robust against these changes in order to be practically relevant. Before I talk about concrete algorithms, let's try to classify types of localization systems that are out there. I'm going to use a taxonomy that is based on the scene representation. One of them is image-based. A simple example is image retrieval. So you have a set of database images with known poses. You have a new test image, and you try to figure out the visually most similar database image and then approximate the pose of the test image by the pose of the retrieved image. Or if you want to have something more accurate, you can retrieve multiple relevant images and interpolate their poses based on visual similarity to the test image in the hope that this interpolated pose is more accurate. A more modern solution is absolute pose regression. The idea is that you train a CNN that takes an image as input and outputs the corresponding camera pose. So these are typically trained per scene, and we recently showed that quite often they are not much better than pose interpolation if they're better than pose interpolation. A more accurate way of getting a pose is pose triangulation. The idea is you again have a database of images, you have a test image, you compute the relative pose between the test image and some relevant database images. From each relative pose, you get an idea in which direction the test image is with respect to a retrieved database image. You intersect these directions and you get the pose of the test image. And this can be done very accurately. Obviously, you can also try to regress this. So you train a CNN that takes two images as input. One of them is your test image. The other is the retrieved database image. It computes the relative pose from one image to the other. And given that you know the absolute pose of one of the images, you get the absolute pose of the test image. Another thing to do is semi-generalized relative poses. The idea is that you have your test image, you retrieve multiple relevant database images, you do feature matching between the test image and the retrieved images, and given that you know the absolute poses of these two retrieved images and the 2D feature matches, you can get the absolute pose of the test image. This is semi-generalized in the sense of that the two retrieved images form a generalized camera, meaning a camera with multiple centers of projections, whereas the test image is a standard pinhole image. And you can do this for relative pose, or you can also do semi-generalized tomography, where we recently presented a paper on this topic, which had the advantage that it's actually significantly more efficient to compute than the semi-generalized relative pose. So this is one set of methods. The other set of methods is what I would call structure-based methods. So they somewhere explicitly or implicitly store the 3D structure of the scene. A simple one is feature-based localization, meaning for each 3D, you have a set of 3D points, for example, computed using structure for motion or SLAM. And for each 3D point, you have an associated feature descriptor from some image. You have your new test image, you extract features, you figure out what are the corresponding 3D points based on the extracted descriptors. And that gives you a set of 2D, 3D matches that you can use for pose estimation. A modernized version of this is removing feature detection description matching stage in terms of having explicit subparts and just trains a CNN that predicts a set of 2D, 3D correspondences or essentially tries to predict the corresponding 3D point for each pixel in the image. That again gives you 2D, 3D correspondences, and you can do pose estimation, for example, by applying a P3P or PNP solver inside Ransom. Related to this is pose refinement, where feature-based localization methods and scene-coordinate regressors estimate the pose from scratch. Pose refinement essentially assumes that you have a pose prior. That could be, for example, the pose of a retrieved image. You initialize your test pose with that one. You project 3D points into the image. You compare them, these projections against what you see in the image, and you try to adjust the camera pose in a way that maximizes the similarity of the projection of the real image. Of course, this taxonomy is not one or the other. You can think of hybrid methods. So hierarchical localization methods, for example, first use image retrieval, so some image-based representation. For the top retrieved images, they look up what are the corresponding 3D points using some structure-based representation, and then do only feature matching against these visible 3D points. Or you could do a hybrid pose estimation where instead of only computing 2D, 3D matches, like in feature-based localization, or 2D, 2D matches, such as in this semi-generalized setting, you compute both 2D, 3D, and 2D, 2D matches, and use those for pose estimation. So this was meant as to give you an idea of what type of methods are out there. If you're interested in more details, feel free to drop me an email. What I'm going to talk about today is two things. I'm going to talk about pose refinement, and then I want to compare feature-based methods with scene coordinate regressors. So let's start with pose refinement methods. So the motivation here is hierarchical localization. So as a short brief recap, the idea is if I'm given a test image, I try to figure out what's the most similar image what are the most similar images in a database of images with known poses. For those retrieved images, I can figure out what are the corresponding 3D points that are visible by those images in the scene. Then for each 3D point, I have a feature descriptor coming from the retrieved image. I can do feature matching between the test image and the retrieved image. And that gives me 2D, 3D correspondences that I can use for pose estimation. And these pipelines work very well. I would say they are state of the art when it comes to long-term localization. If nowadays you would use learned features such as D2Net, SuperPoint, or other things, and these are actually quite robust against even strong changes. So here you see D2Net feature matches between two images taken at very different times of the year. And when I first saw the result, I was very surprised how much you can actually still match, given that appearance has changed so much. But the question is also, do we actually need to do this detection and matching stage explicitly? Because what we're currently doing is we're just getting from the retrieval stage, we get an idea of what is visible or potentially visible in the test image. What we're ignoring is the pose of this retrieved image. And it turns out that you cannot just try to do refinement starting from the pose of the retrieved image and then trying to converge to the actual pose of the test image. And this is essentially some work that we presented at CVPR 2021. The first authors are Paul-Edouard Sardin and AJ Unaka. And the idea is rather simple. It's essentially the same thing as you would do in a direct SLAM method. You have a query image, you have a retrieved image, you have a set of 3D points visible in this retrieved image, and then you run a CNN over the query image and the retrieved image from the CNN features extracted for the retrieved image, you can associate them with the 3D points. And then starting with an initial pose estimate for the query, you project the points into the image. You compute feature residuals. So for this point, you know what's the corresponding CNN feature in the retrieved image. You compare the feature against the feature that you extract at the position of the projection in the query image. That gives you residuals in feature space. And then you can try to refine your pose estimate as to minimize those residuals in feature space. So that's essentially a photometric version of a feature metric version of a standard photometric loss used in direct SLAM. And you typically do this in multiple iterations. At some point, you will switch to like a more fine-grained feature map, where you first want to use like a coarser map to ensure a larger basin of convergence. And then you would like to use a finer map to make sure that you get the precise pose. And here is an example of running this. So what you see here is the initial pose, and the red pose is the current pose estimate. This is the reference image. This is the query image. So it's the same building, but taken at night. These are the three points that are visible in the reference image. This is the projection of these points based on the pose. So this is the red points. In green, you see the ground truth projection of where these 3D points should project into the image. And keep in mind, the method does not have access to these green projections here, only to the 3D points visible in this image. And here you see how it adjusts the pose as to try to best align the features corresponding to 3D points with the features extracted in the test image. As you can see, even though we start quite far away from the real pose, so probably a couple of meters, it still converges to something that's highly accurate. This approach can be trained end-to-end. So we use a UNet-like architecture that processes each image. Then after the bottleneck layer, we start with the coarsest CNN map. We predict two things. We predict the confidence that each pixel, whether it's useful for localization or not, and some features. And then given an initial pose estimate for the query image and the pose for the reference image and the 3D points in the visible in the reference image, we get features from the feature map in corresponding to the reference image, project them into the query image, and then get weighted residuals, which is essentially the difference between like the feature corresponding to the 3D point in the reference image and the feature corresponding to the projection in the query image, weighted by the confidence that we have. And then we essentially get these feature residuals in feature space, and we do Leeuwenberg-Marquardt with learned dampening factor. The idea here is that we learn like an importance for each element of the pose, which allows us to handle certain types of motion. So for example, if you think of a self-driving car, this will most likely only move in a plane. There is no rotation about the principal axis in the cameras. So this is what this approach learns. So it makes it highly unlikely that the Leeuwenberg-Marquardt optimization will try to rotate the image in this direction. We run this for a couple of iterations by essentially unrolling the optimization to a fixed number of steps. That gives us an updated pose estimate. And what the signal, training signal that we're using is essentially the difference between the pose estimate that we get from Leeuwenberg-Marquardt and the ground truth pose for the query image. So after a fixed number of iterations on the coarsest feature map, we move one feature map up to something that has a higher dimension, a higher spatial dimension, and thus features that are more localized, better localized in the image. We again get a confidence and a set of features and do the same thing. Unroll optimization, minimize the difference between the estimated and ground truth pose, and then move on to the next stage. And all of this can be trained end to end. We do not require like any labelings for these confidences or features. The only thing that we require are 3D points and camera poses. And the approach generalizes actually quite well. So here you see alignment results in an indoor scene for a network that was only trained on outdoor scenes. So it actually has learned features that seem to generalize quite well. And what's interesting is actually that you can get these confidence scores on a per pixel basis. So here you see the output of the confidence score for a given image. And essentially what it has learned is it has learned to ignore cars. It has learned to ignore the interiors of buildings, but what it mostly looks at is contours. So contours between a building and a sky, contours between a tree and everything else. So it looks at fine grained structures, because this is essentially where a lot of alignment information is, which is intuitively makes sense. If you think of a direct slam method, you look at high gradient pixels. And this is kind of the same thing that it that the network figures out for itself. So this is really without any supervision on this confidence score part. So this was actually the shorter part of the talk. So what I talked about was to directly refine camera poses based on some sort of measurement of feature consistency by reprojecting points into images and thus transferring features from one image to the other, which is essentially like a feature metric version of this direct or photometric refinement used in methods such as LSD-SLAM. And we were not the first to do something like this. There's work from Sturmberg and others, students of Daniel Kramer's group, that have done this work. Simon Lucy has done work in this direction. And what I liked about it is that you essentially build like a pose regression approach, but still integrate classical optimization techniques such as Levenberg-Marquardt that you use to train it and that you also use to optimize a pose at test time. And the nice thing is that it's really, you just need pose supervision. You don't need any per pixel labels or correspondences between the images. And it generalized quite well. But of course, how well it works depends on how close the initial pose is to the pose to which you want to converge. If that's too far away, you're most likely going to end up in some bad local minima and not converge. If you want to try it out, the source code is by now publicly available. It's an implementation in PyTorch. It's quite easy to run. Okay, that concludes this part. I'm not sure if there's questions to this part now or whether you want to do questions later.
Let's do Q&A at the end.
I think we can do questions later.
Okay, perfect. Sounds good to me. Good, then let's get to the second longer part, which is comparison of feature-based methods and scene coordinate regressors. So feature-based localization is the assumption is you're given some 3D model computed using SLAM, structure for motion, and you're given a test image. And the first thing that you do is you're going to detect features, SIFT, or whatever you prefer. For each feature detection, you're going to extract compute a feature descriptor, and then you're going to do descriptor matching between the features you extracted in the test image and image descriptors assigned to the 3D points in your model. Once you have those 2D-3D matches, you can do camera pose estimation by essentially trying to find the pose that best aligns the 3D points and the projection of the 3D points into the test image and the corresponding feature detections. And the typical way to do this is to apply RANSAC and some endpoint pose on. Nowadays, you would use some sort of learned feature detector, some learned feature descriptor. There are learned feature matches that work really well. But I like to refer to this pipeline as old school localization in the sense of that this pipeline, or many of these stages of the pipeline, are actually quite old. So feature detection description, the seminal work there is SIFT, which was published in 1999. And there were weaker detectors, descriptors available before. Feature descriptor matching, like one seminal work there, RKD trees for fast matching of in spaces. That paper is from the 70s. And the earliest mentions of the 3-point pose problem, which is a minimal version of the endpoint pose problem, date back to the 700s. And Ransack was published in the 80s. And the natural question is this still like a valid pipeline, or can we do better? And this is where scene coordinate regression comes into our place. The idea is that rather having an explicit detection description matching stage, we just train a single CNN that takes a pixel or patches input and tries to predict the corresponding 3D point in the world. And once you have those points, you get 2D, 3D matches, and you can do post estimation. So how do these two methods compare to each other? There is a bit of common belief in the literature, and this is what I'm going to talk about, is joint work with Eric Brachmann, Martin Humberger, and Carsten Botha, and we presented this at ICCV this year. So there's a set of common data sets used for evaluation. There are the 7 scenes and 12 scenes indoor data sets. The evaluation metric is the essentially percentage of images localized within 5 centimeters, 5 degrees. So higher is better. Green bars are feature-based methods using either only images or images and depths. And purple is scene coordinate regressors using either only images or images and depths. The conclusion from these results is that scene coordinate regressors are more accurate than feature-based methods, because here the best performing methods that you have are scene coordinate regressors. And also the common belief is RGBD-based methods are better than RGB-based methods if you're indoors. And the rationale for why these scene coordinate regressors are better than feature-based methods is that scene coordinate regressors give you dense predictions, feature-based methods give you sparse predictions, and indoors having denser predictions should be helpful or should be better. If you look at popular outdoor data sets such as Cambridge Landmarks or the Aachen Day data set, then this reverses. So here for Cambridge, you see the median position error. For Aachen, you see the percentage of images within 25 centimeters, 2 degrees. So smaller is better here, higher is better there. And there you see that feature-based methods outperform scene coordinate regressors. So the common belief is that feature-based methods are better than scene coordinate regressors in outdoor scenes or in scenes that are larger in scale. But what we wanted to do is we wanted to have a closer look at these benchmark results. So what a benchmark ideally should do is, given some algorithm A and the ground truth, it should measure the difference in the prediction of in the pose predicted by algorithm A and the ground truth pose. The problem is that how do you get ground truth? The ground truth that you're looking for is some 6-dimensional vector position in space and an orientation of the camera. And you could try to ask the human to give you to label these, but humans are really bad at giving you precise camera pose estimates. You can try to annotate 2D, 3D, 2D, 2D matches between images and then try to estimate poses from this. But even annotating matches precisely is not easy, and it's something that doesn't really scale. So that's not a good approach. You can try to use a sensor, like a GPS sensor if you're outdoors, some ultrasound localization system indoors. or some Wicon system, but the problem here is it doesn't scale that easily to many scenes, especially indoors, where you would need to set up the sensor system, calibrate it. That's not fun at all. So what is typically done is you use some algorithm to generate what we call pseudo-grounders. So you use SLAM system, structure of motion system, where you batch optimize over all images and then use the obtained poses as grounders. And essentially, since your ground truth that you're using for evaluation is not absolute, but was generated by some algorithm, what localization benchmarks essentially measure is how well an algorithm is able to replicate the poses that were generated by some by the method that you chose to generate the pseudo ground truths. So that means you can actually generate different versions of pseudo ground truths depending on which algorithm you use to generate it. And a natural question is, how important is this choice of this pseudo ground truth? Ideally, it should not matter at all. You should get the same localization results independently of how you get to the pseudo ground truths. But it turns out that this is actually not the case. So if you choose an algorithm that generates pseudo ground truths, you also have to make a choice of what you actually would like to optimize, what you would like this algorithm to optimize. One option is you optimize some 3D error, so point-to-plane error, point-to-point error, for example, in depth space lab. Or you try to optimize an error in image space, so for example, a 2D reprojection error in like RGB, SLAM, or in structure for motion. We generated two types of pseudo ground truths for the most popular, the very popular 7 and 12 scenes data sets. For both data sets, there was RGBD ground truths using some depth space SLAM. Here's Kinect Fusion for this 7 scenes scene. And we also used structure for motion to generate a second set of pseudo ground truth poses using the Colmak package. And here you see those two aligned, and it turns out that in some regions they align quite well, in others there's actually quite some discrepancy between the estimated poses. And this actually has quite some impact. So here you see in red pseudo ground truth poses generated using Kinect Fusion, which uses RGBD, or mostly actually depths. And green, you see the poses estimated using active search, which is like a nearly 10-year-old localization method based on SIF features that I worked on in my PhD. And here on the left, you see the reprojection of the scene into the image based on the estimated pose. And as you can see, the pose estimates are quite noisy. And when I saw the results, a few years ago, I figured, well, it's probably hard because there's not that many features that you can find. So your poses are not well constrained and you get a lot of noise. But actually, this is the results that you get with the same method and just different pseudo ground truth poses. In this case, generated using structure for motion. You see, there's much less shake and you're actually quite close to the ground truth poses, which is astonishing because all you changed is the way that you generated the pseudo ground truths, and you get significantly better results. And that's not like an outlier. Here you can see the results of DSEC star, which is a scene coordinate regression method that uses RGBD images. Where for each pixel in the RGB image, it predicts a corresponding 3D point in the scene using scene coordinate regression, and then it uses the depth values for the corresponding pixel to solve a 3D alignment problem. And you see on the left, you see the poses estimated by DSEC star compared to like a depth space SLAM pseudo ground truths on the right compared to this structure motion pseudo ground truths. And you can see that here on the left, where you're where both the pseudo ground truths and your algorithm optimize the 3D error, you actually get quite good alignments. Here you have much more noise and actually consistent drift here as well. So if you compare this to the active search poses, then on this pseudo ground truth, DSAG star is clearly better than active search. However, on the structure for motion ground truth, it actually reverses. Active search is much better than DSAG star, or is better than DSAG star, which is not the behavior that you would like to have if you benchmark algorithms. So a benchmark intuitively should be objective. So if a method performs better, if method A performs better than method B on the benchmark, this should imply that method A is better than method B. Yet this suggests that it's not that easy, but the way that the ground truth was generated, pseudo ground truth was generated, plays a part. That is assuming that both pseudo ground truths are equally good. So let's look at this next. So a natural question is one better than the other? If yes, then we should only use this and not the other. Here's the 3D points generated using based on local features. So for the structure for motion ground truth, this is the output of structure for motion. For the kinetic fusion part, we took the poses, we matched features between the images, and then we triangulated the scene. And as you can see, you get much cleaner point clouds with much less noise with the structure for motion pseudo ground truth, which is not that surprising because that's essentially what you're trying to optimize. You're trying to minimize, you're trying to optimize 3D points so that they nicely fit to a set of feature measurements, which is not what you optimize for in kinetic fusion. So in this case, based on this metric, which is the metric optimized by structure motion, the structure motion ground truth is better. Let's look at like a dense representation that you get by essentially fusing depth maps based on the poses that you get from the two algorithms. So on the right, you see the structure motion pseudo ground truth. On the left, you see the kinetic fusion one. What you can see is that the structure for motion version is globally more consistent, and things that are far apart away for, or rather far away from the cameras are more consistent. But if you look at the foreground, then you actually get more consistent results with the depth space slam method compared to structure for motion. Likely because there are very few features found on these structures. So you still get a lot of inliers on things in the back, not that many on the front. So you get biases in your poses. And this is something that we consistently saw with the data sets that we looked at. So this is like the global structure of the 12 scenes data set, where the depth space slam method, which is actually not kinetic fusion but bundled fusion, is slightly bent, where structure motion gives you globally more consistent things. But if you look at local structures, you have them much cleaner in the depth space slam compared to structure for motion. So from this, we concluded that there's not necessarily a better ground truth. Both are equally valid. Both give you better results in certain aspects and worse results in others. But you can't just discard one over the other. And if you consider both, then you can actually compare how methods do depending on the chosen pseudo ground truth. This is the ranking that you get for the original kinetic fusion based pseudo ground truth. Higher this percentage of images localized within 5 centimeters, 5 degrees, higher is better. And you see that here, RGBD methods, classical methods, active search, which is based on local features, does not work that well. And scene coordinate regressors are better than other methods. And methods that you use using RGBD are better than methods that outperform RGB, that use RGB only. If you use the structure for motion ground truth, then this ranking reverses, and all of a sudden this classical method actually works quite well, and in fact actually outperforms machine coordinate regressors. And also you get better results with when using RGB and ignoring depths than if you use RGBD. So what these experiments show is that these commonly held statements or assumptions that you can find in the literature are correct or wrong depending on how you define your pseudo ground truths, which is a bit of a surprising result, as I said, because it means that we can't trust benchmarks that we have too much. But you can still use them to compare others. So one way to do this would be to look at Pareto optimality. So here you see the performance on one on the depth space slam pseudo ground truths on the y-axis and the structural motion based pseudo ground truths on the x-axis. And you can essentially try to figure out where is the Pareto fault. So any method below on the left of this line is worse than is clearly worse than the others. These two methods you can't directly compare because active search is better in terms of SFM ground truths. DSEC star is better in terms of the depth space slam ground truths. So here you get a set of methods where you say they are all good, but I can't necessarily compare them. The alternative is to say I'm actually taking into account how similar a method is to the way that the pseudo ground truth was generated. So here you have methods in green that optimize a similar objective, in this case, 3D alignment error, as is optimized by the method that generated the ground truth. Red is something that optimizes a different objective. Blue is something that partially optimizes, and in part optimizes the objective used by the ground truth algorithm. And then what you could do is you would only compare methods within a group, but not between groups, because you say, we observe that a method that tries to mimic the way the pseudo ground truth was generated is better than methods that optimize a different cost function. So I can't directly compare. From a practical side, that means that you should use a localization algorithm that mimics the way that you generated your scene representations. Good, so in terms of lessons learned, there's an interesting observation that the way the pseudo ground truth is generated has a much larger impact on localization performance and our understanding of localization performance than what we previously thought. And this also means that we should question some of the common beliefs that we draw from published results and that people have stated in the literature. I think there's a lot of interesting work that can be done in this area. So one is, can we theoretically link different pseudo ground truths? So if we have one pseudo ground truth, can we predict what is the best accuracy that I could achieve if I have a method that optimizes a different cost function, or the best accuracy, how the accuracy of one pseudo ground truth relates to the other. Another interesting thing to look into is synthetic data. So can we prevent the whole problem by operating in some synthetic spaces? So just render data, for example, where we actually have access to the ground truth posts. I think that's an interesting direction, but I think there are also some pitfalls. So here are two real images. This is the city hall in Aachen, where I did my PhD. And if I run like a state-of-the-art feature detector and matcher, superpoint, superglue, I find about 115 inliers, I think, to a homography estimated between the images. If I replace those real images with renderings of the three model that I obtained from a state-of-the-art 3D reconstruction software, in this case, reality capture. So these are renderings of a colored mesh taken from the same poses. If I run the same feature match on top of this, I get about twice as many inlier matches. So what seems to be happening here is that, or at least my experience is that, synthetic data is to some degree too easy and too consistent in the sense of there's a lot of low-level statistics that seem to be like the same, and whereas real data is affected by some noise that we're currently not modeling there. Something is missing, but I think it can probably be simulated using some CNN. But it's still, I mean, it's an interesting direction because you get absolute ground truths. And there are interesting things that you can use, such as neural radiance fields, to generate realistic, to synthesize realistic images, or maybe operate directly on synthetic data and try to adapt it to have real data statistics using some GAN or image translation approach. Okay, to wrap things up, I talked about comparing methods on these indoor benchmarks from this paper. How does it relate to long-term localization algorithms? Because that's the topic of the talk. For long-term localization, you kind of want to generate pseudo-ground truths in scenarios where existing algorithms do not work that well. And we actually built a set of benchmark algorithms. So for some, we use per image annotations. So we would, for example, for the Aachen Day Night dataset, for a given daytime image with known 3 points, we would try to annotate the corresponding pixels in the nighttime image to get the correspondences that we were not able to compute automatically. For the InLog scene, InLog dataset, which is two large university buildings, we used a similar strategy. For some sequences, for some datasets, we use per sequence annotations. So this is the extended CMU seasons dataset, which is based on the CMU long-term localization dataset released, I think, about 10 years ago, where we reconstructed each traversal of the car individually, chopped it up into like smaller chunks, and then annotated correspondences between 3 points in one trajectory and images in the other trajectory. We did something similar for a dataset that we presented at ICV, which is based, like has short sequences mined from Mapillary, but distributed much more diversely over the world than the datasets that were available before. In some datasets, we used additional sensors. So for the robot car seasons dataset, which is built on top of the robot car dataset from Oxford, we used the LiDAR sensor that they had for the Rio 10 dataset. We used like a depth sensor that was available for all the cameras. And all these data sets are like available. Car-driven will be released later, but the others are available online. And I think after seeing the results for the indoor data sets, and seeing that the way that the pseudo-ground truth is generated has such a large impact on how we rank and understand localization algorithms, I think there's a very interesting question here that is how does the way that we generated pseudo-ground truths for these challenging data sets affect the ranking of visual localization algorithms on that? Yeah, I think that's an interesting direction for future work. This is the end of my talk. Thank you very much for listening. And also a big thanks to all the talented and great people that I had the pleasure of working with. Here's hopefully most of those whose papers are mentioned in this talk. And yeah, if there are any questions, I'm happy to answer them.
Thank you for the talk. I think I learned a lot. It's pretty interesting to see like how pseudo-ground truth would actually affect our the benchmark results. And it's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Okay, let's see if we have any questions. Okay, the first question is, can you please give some insight in your personal process on how to find new scientific contribution in this area?
It's an iterative process. You try something out, you either observe that it's not working and you try to understand, is this a fundamental limitation that I, if yes, then that's something like an interesting new research direction, and you can try to fix this. Or is this just something that you assume, this should be better if I try it like this way, but it turns out that like a naive approach already gives you like nearly as good accuracy, and then you don't benefit from doing something more advanced. And I've certainly had my shares of the later two things. But in general, it's really, once you are in a topic, you are in the position that you can try to explore it further. You see what works, you see what doesn't work, you try to understand why doesn't it work. This is essentially how we ended up with the second paper that I presented from ICU this year. We saw that one family of methods works very well, the other doesn't work that well. We try to understand why this is the case. As part of this, we regenerated ground truths using structure motion, and we saw that this interesting behavior, and we try to analyze it in more detail.
Thanks. I don't see any other questions here. Maybe I can start with some. So in the first part of the talk, you mentioned training a hierarchical deep direct method with only post supervision. And yep. Can you comment more on the pros and cons of that method? I mean, how does it work on the real world visual localization? Or does it require much training data? Or?
We trained it on, so we had two data sets that we trained it on. One was the Megadeps data set, which is, I think, 100 landmarks scraped from, 100 popular landmarks scraped from Flickr and under other photo community websites. That worked quite well for non-driving data sets. For self-driving car data sets, we actually trained on part of the CMU Seasons data set. And that made a significant difference. Part of this is because the semantics of these scenes are different. So for self-driving cars, you see cars on the road, you drive on the road, you have a restricted motion model, whereas you're not seeing that many cars or other occluders in the landmark scenario. In terms of but we didn't have to really try hard to find suitable training data. That worked reasonably well out of the box, and we've seen that it generalizes reasonably well to like from landmarks to indoor scenes. In terms of the second part, how well it works, it can get close to state-of-the-art accuracy of like feature-based methods. We are still slightly worse. I don't think that's a fundamental limitation. So we started from the pose of the top retrieved image, and the top retrieved image does not necessarily always need to be relevant. Whereas the feature-based methods that we compared against use the top 20 or so retrieved images. We haven't figured out yet how to start from multiple poses and then select the best one. That's, I think, still an open problem. But I would expect that it's a solvable problem, and that doing it this way, you should get close in performance, or should get the same performance.
Thanks. We have another question here. Do all the pseudo ground truths yield identical results in simulation where the noise is simulated? And what metrics can we define to select the most faithful ground truths for various scenes and scenarios?
That's a very good question. No, we did not try to run things on simulated data. And I also, I'm not sure if this is that interesting of an experiment, because if you don't have noise, I would expect that everything gives you something very close to the actual ground truth. the real problem seems to be that you have noisy observations in the real world. Noise, like low level noise on images, like distortion effects that might not be perfectly modeled in your calibrations, or that the structural motion algorithm might not be able to perfectly model noise in your depth measurements, quantization artifacts, other things. And then the question is, how do you realistically model this noise? And once you, I think then it's an interesting experiment. The second question was what's the good definition of magic? What's a better ground truth, pseudo ground truth? I don't think that there is a general metric that you could use to define this. I think where you want to go into is not evaluate localization algorithms in isolation, but as part of larger systems. Because localization itself is not a problem, but it's a sub-problem of, say, navigation or augmented reality, things like this. So I think what you want to evaluate is not, can I estimate a pose within 5 centimeters, 5 degrees, but does the localization algorithm help me achieve the higher level tasks that I have? Does it help me reach a goal? So meaning, can I localize efficiently enough to do this in real time? Does it allow me to project virtual content with high accuracy and very little jitter into my images? So I think those are much more interesting metrics to optimize. Regarding what's a better pseudo ground truth, I don't know. So if you looked at the results that I showed for the indoor scenes, where you have like globally more consistent structural motion, then I would say structural motion is better if you are looking at a navigation task where you want to go from point A to point B, because globally these things are consistent. If you're more looking at an augmented reality application where you're only seeing a small part of the scene at the same time, then you probably don't care about global consistency. You're much more concerned about local consistency and being able to use the depths to handle occlusions. So then the RGBD-based pseudo ground is probably what you're looking for. So I think, again, it's a question of what do you want? What's the scenario that you're operating
in? Thanks. So in the end of the day, it's about application, and can we actually achieve the task we want?
Yeah, I think that's the natural next thing to look at, and not do this, I get 5 centimeter better on this data set on average. That's not really a meaningful metric, I think.
Thanks, that's a great point. I guess we can take a last question. What advice would you give for a newbie trying to collect his own long-term data set?
Start small and iterate, I think. I don't think that the long-term localization, SLAM, whatever data set necessarily needs to be large scale. You could just do like a single street, a single house, a single room over time, because in many cases, at least for localization, can make a point that you're not all of a sudden lost in an unknown country on an unknown planet, but you have a good guess of where you are from, say, cell phone data, GPS. So you can really break down this localization problem into, can I get data association between like an image taken on a new condition and whatever I have in the scene that I took like at an earlier point in time. And this can be done at small scale. And small scale acquisition is typically much easier than large scale acquisition. And I think then if you focus on small scale, you can focus on like concrete failure cases. So I guess the second recommendation would be look at the data sets, figure out what cases are missing. Record data, take state-of-the-art methods and see whether they fail on these small test cases or not. If they fail, then you have an interesting test case and a potentially interesting benchmark.
Thanks. I think we are running out of time. But thank you for a great talk today. So I think that's all.
Thank you very much for the opportunity and for the invitation. I very much enjoyed it. Thank you, and thanks for the great questions.